And quite typically, this type of warhead can penetrate approximately 300 millimetres of steel. So if you take a look at this steel stack that I've got here, that means it can penetrate 1, 2, 3 layers of steel. Other variants of this type of warhead can penetrate anything up to between 700 or even 800 millimetres of steel. So it's a very, very dangerous threat.
But what can be done to stop shaped charges penetrating a tank turret? A young Manfred Helt went to the Middle East after the Six-Day War of 1967 to test shaped charges against the armour of wrecked tanks left in the desert. He saw it as an opportunity to work with real armour out in the field. As he filmed his work, he noticed some tanks were less damaged after the explosion. He realized that his charge had detonated the munitions stored in the turret. The blast had somehow cancelled out the force of his shaped charge. Manfred had stumbled on something with amazing potential. He'd hit on what he called explosive reactive armor. Explosive reactive armor consists of a sheet of high explosive sandwiched between two steel plates. When a penetrating weapon hits it, the explosive layer detonates, forcing the two metal plates apart, repelling the incoming missile. Manfred Helt's design comes in the form of explosive boxes fixed to the outside of a tank. It's one of the more recent concepts in armor. To demonstrate Manfred's invention, we've asked him and Sidney Alford to fire another shaped charge.
What we'll do now, we'll fire exactly the same charge, at exactly the same distance, at exactly the same target. But this time, we now have a layer of Professor Helt's armour.
One drawback with explosive reactive armour is that anyone outside the tank is in danger of being hit by flying shrapnel. Sydney has built a protective canopy to try and contain the fragments.
Everybody ready?
I'm ready.
Okay. Firing! 4, 3, 2, 1. Oh-ho!
Some of the steel plates look as though they've been penetrated.
This is interesting. It's deflected the shot considerably. The actual penetration is, I think, much less. And may I congratulate you, Professor Helt, your armour has worked very well. It hasn't come through.
No, there's
a hole here, and that implies that the piece of armour hit it there and continued going. How far it went, I'm not sure.
When the 10 steel plates are laid out alongside those from the previous experiment, it's clear explosive reactive armor has protected the inside of the turret. The charge has only penetrated the top 3 layers of armor.
I think that this is a pretty unambiguous demonstration of the effectiveness of reactive armor. That's pretty conclusive.
It's conclusive.
Explosive reactive armor marked a watershed in the battle between weapons and protection. New technologies mean the future may lie with active armor systems that detect and detonate warheads before they get close to a tank. For designers, this is the Holy Grail. They could take away tons of passive, heavy, conventional armor and devise smaller, lighter vehicles. This would answer some strategists who feel that the concept of the tank is outdated and that modern armies need faster vehicles for rapid reaction forces.
Do we need tanks anymore? I mean, that's for other people to decide, but we better think about it. This evolution has been an armor anti-armor, mobile protected firepower against the enemy's counter. I think you're always going to have a tank-like vehicle. Hell, let's not call it a tank anymore. I don't care. Call it a horse. But I think what we have to have is, what is it that's going to fulfill the role that the tank plays today on tomorrow's battlefield?
One proposal is this, the Stryker. It doesn't yet have active armor, but it's lighter and more mobile than the Abrams. It's available in many different versions and was designed to be airlifted into war zones. Inside, a self-loading gun and a virtual battlefield on screens add to the complexity of the technology that can go wrong. Used in the recent conflict in Iraq, it was found wanting. Its armor couldn't keep out cheap and readily available rocket-propelled grenades. Once equipped with the extra protection needed, the Stryker becomes too large to be airlifted and deployed quickly. Over the last 100 years, the tank has benefited from countless improvements in technology and established itself as the supreme armored fighting vehicle. The big question is, has it reached its limits? As the escalating battle between firepower and protection gathers pace once more, designers have plenty to keep them busy to keep this machine of war, the tank, in the front line.